Patricia OLYNYK, our next speaker. Patricia OLYNYK is director of the Graduate School of Art and Florence and Frank Bush Professor of Art at the Sam Fox School of Design and Visual Arts, Washington University in St. Louis. I think there's something.
It's a scroll.
She has also taught at the University of Michigan in the School of Art and Design in Ann Arbor, where she became one of the first artists in the US to be appointed as a research professor to the scientific unit. As former chair of the Leonardo Education and Art Forum, the International Society for the Arts, Science and Technology, OLYNYK co-organizes NY Lasers in New York, a program that convenes monthly in New York, which includes artists, scientists, theorists, and creators for fourth cross-disciplinary dialogues. And just, sorry, I forgot before, to be clear about the terminology, Michael Wimmer talked about a workshop before. He meant the discussion.
Sorry.
It's not the workshop. The workshops are the other four parts. Still this workshop and this is the discussion. But he mentioned what he will talk about. So thank you for your talk.
Many dexterous here. Okay, thank you everybody for coming and thank you for that wonderful introduction, much appreciated. So, title of my talk, of course, Evolving Through Culture, Thinking, and Art and Science. This presentation will explore just a small selection of curricular initiatives, research models, fellows programs, and collaborations that support creative work and research at the intersections of art, science, technology, with a special focus on a recent Mellon Foundation-funded vertical seminar that I taught, and also an art science fellows group that I formed at Washington University. And with this last initiative, faculty and graduate students considered the realms of science and art with a view to challenge the notion that these are incommensurable realms of knowledge. Science historian Thomas Kuhn once proposed that it's most productive to explore art and science as products of human activity, that while images are the inevitable outcomes of art making, they function only as tools when used to advance scientific knowledge. And as we know today, this assertion is being challenged. A recent joint meeting of the National Science Foundation and the National Endowment for the Arts engaged influential thinkers and teachers in exploring opportunities for advancing scientific knowledge and new forms of artistic research, output, engagement, and collaboration. The results suggest that building sustainable platforms for cross-disciplinary discourse and activities that engage both domains is timely and relevant. The life sciences are generating new conversations and collaborations between artists and members of the scientific community. Such partnerships have the capacity to incite reasoned debate on controversial issues associated with advances in science and medicine, and also expand the possibilities for understanding the impacts of science and technology on the human condition and also on all living systems. The Scandalera Center for Entrepreneurship, which is a center at Washington University, typically provides funding for startup groups. I managed to convince this center that convening artists, scientists, and humanists together was in and of itself an entrepreneurial project, and they bought it, and I think rightly so. So the Scandalera Center recently provided a substantial funding to launch a new fellows program to serve as a platform for serendipitous conversations between artists and scientists on campus, and also to act as an incubator for future collaborations, creative work, entrepreneurial initiatives, and also new research. The program brought together a group of 16 members, including four MFA students and PhD students from across campus, to share their work and their research. Notably, it served as a conduit for collaborations between art, design, and architecture on the one hand, that constitutes the Sam Fox School where I'm from, And on the other hand, divisions such as medicine, biology, psychology, neuroscience, philosophy, and engineering on the other. And I think part of the success of this project is that it was agnostic. It wasn't owned by a certain school or department. It was owned by nobody, and it served everyone. And I think this is really key to the exchange of ideas. Group members met approximately 10 times over the course of the semester to share their work. Presentations centered on such diverse topics as the split brain phenomenon and its relationship to consciousness, architecture and the anatomy of space, the study of the parietal cortex in processing visual spatial information, the influence of optics on 18th century theater, anatomical modeling in early modern Italy, and the neuroscience of mental imagery. One intended outcome of these exchanges was to establish a core of stakeholders keen to develop a stronger tie between the sciences, the humanities, and the arts, and formalize programs integrating arts and the sciences at Washington University. These outcomes are already being realized with emerging partnerships among fellows and also between institutions, Washington University and UCLA in California. In the words of one faculty participant, Professor Rebecca Messbarger, this is exactly the kind of pioneering cross-disciplinary teamwork that should define the university culture. One of the new initiatives that emerged as the semester progressed was a team-taught interdisciplinary medical humanities course, The Art of Medicine, which was shaped more precisely through discussions that transpired in the ArtSci Fellows group, is supported by an interdisciplinary teaching grant from the provost, and it was also a major influence on the conceptualization of a medical humanities minor. The principal aim of this course is for students to learn to see medicine as a social practice deeply implicated in the beliefs and struggles of particular cultural and historical contexts. The ArtSci Fellows program also included architect Sung Ho Kim, who collaborated with two plant scientists on original research integrating biological and architectural materials. Their work extends pre-existing architectural discourse and research on green projects, and additionally re-engineer single-cell moss, which filters harmful pollutants into new living architectural forms. Professor Kim believes it is critical that designers use knowledge from other scientific fields. Cellular transformation research uses cross-disciplinary approaches that their research methods are designed to allow for more, in a way that allows for more collaborative practices to emerge. And this model actually has designers, engineers, and biologists that are brought together at the beginning of a design process instead of brought in the final stages of a design project, which is typically the case. He also thinks that architecture is lagging behind biology and engineering in terms of new advances. So bringing everybody together at the table at the beginning of the project, he's saying, is key to the success. And this is some of the cellular transformation research documents that they've produced. So an integrated model combines visual design exploration along with conceptual understanding of the principles underlying biological architecture, with a particular emphasis on the structures and processes found in the complex architecture within cells. So, and again, this differs from standard green projects in that the plant scientists and the architect are working together to actually create living architecture. So this is a sample from that. Here's an example of some of the moss that's growing on these architectural armatures. Kathy Miller, who is our chair of biology, discussed the power of images and the ways in which imaging has revolutionized biological research, specifically in the field of cell biology. From the conversations that were generated, several program participants discovered a common interest in picturing organic forms and structures and have since discussed a kind of artisan labs programs that might be born from all of this. So again, the inclusion of Kathy Miller in the ArtSci Fellows group again, seems fundamental to developing a new program. So, as I mentioned, Washington University and UCLA have been collaborating, and in fact, one of the overarching aims of the Art Sci Fellows program was to develop a formally recognized institutional relationship between the two schools, and establishing something which we have in the U.S. is called an MOU, or a Memorandum of Understanding, and it's a loose agreement that basically says two institutions will collaborate on future initiatives. So upon obtaining the MOU, the ArtSci programs at both institutions jointly conceived a symposium and a catalog project entitled Art in the Brain, Stories and Structures, that convened last November at UCLA's California Nanosystems Institute. Basically, I brought six of my fellows with me to UCLA, and they had four scientists and artists on there, and we co-hosted the symposium. And here's a little bit of what we did. I was getting brain mapped there. This is Dr. Cohen, who heads a research institute in neuroscience there. I was wearing the hydrocell geodesic sensor net. And next I'm going to talk about another agnostic initiative, the Mellon Vertical Seminar, which is a series of seminars. I taught the last in a series of five called Role of Arts Practice in the Research Institution. And I was inspired to do this course from my involvement in an organization in the United States called the Alliance for the Arts in the Research Institution. And I can talk a little bit about this in the discussion group at 4 o'clock, but it's basically a consortium of 30 institutions across the United States that are looking at how to embed arts across campus. And so this, through this seminar, we explored the original creative work produced in collaboration with high-level research activity, as well as the ways in which arts practices are integrated across campus, especially in the sciences. And the seminar also examined the research university itself as being a place that is superbly equipped to facilitate creative and scholarly exchange, and also align conventional and interdisciplinary research that supports new and challenging endeavors. The seminar was open to scholars and practitioners of all different academic levels. The Mellon Foundation grant supported release time, thank you, for faculty, and it also supported the students, the MFA and the PhD students in the seminar with stipends. And the provost has now extended this course in the form of a series of meetings. And we will also produce a book for the seminar. So it's been very, very successful. And basically, participants examined various manifestations of visual art, interactive art, performance art, theater and performing arts, hybrid and transdisciplinary and collaborative practices, many in relation to biology, neuroscience, and social science. And this also included investigations into design thinking, healthcare, visualizing data. The seminar further considered how such practices are perceived and engaged and also utilized in the research environment. So there's all sorts of ways that artists and collaborators define their work, but how the institution actually perceives it is something else. So this is really a summary of the vertical seminar. And again, the university was actually given, I should mention that this vertical seminar program was awarded $500,000 by the Mellon Foundation in the United States. So each course essentially was awarded $100,000 to run. Big investment. One of our guest lecturers included someone that probably many of you know, Dr. Graham Sullivan, who is the head of the Visual Arts School at Penn State, and he authored the book Arts Practices Research. And he presented methodologies used in practice-led research, as well as research-led practice. And he proposed a framework for the former that includes dialectical, conceptual, theoretical, and conceptual approaches. This is one of his charts that puts artists as theorists in the center. And he's got a fantastic website that has a lot of these different models that are actually sketched out in these incredible diagrams. So you can go online and find these. His lecture for us examined various domains of inquiry typically opened up through the artistic research and also undertaken in studio contexts within university settings. Also, the guest speaker in this seminar was Tony Dubb, a New York-based performance and interactive media artist, who focused a lot of her talk on what doesn't work when artists collaborate with research institutions. In fact, she talked about the downfalls of artists who are pressured into appropriating their work to suit the research methodologies of other disciplines. So we weren't just sort of carrying the banner for, you know, all interdisciplinary work. We certainly looked at the models that didn't work as well, and Tony Dove really helped us to consider all of that. And then the last artist I'd like to present, who participated in this, was visual artist Ellen King Levy from New York, who spoke about art, science, and technology, and her work with neuroscientist Mickey Goldberg, who's at Columbia University. And their recent collaboration was an experiment in inattention blindness. And in this case, the experiment was actually conducted in the context of an art exhibition as opposed to a laboratory. And Stealing Attention, which is this piece here, investigates the potential of art as a vehicle for studying attention and attention disorders. Basically, she was looking at artifacts that were stolen from the museum in Iraq during the invasion of Iraq, the Iraq War. And you're asked to count the Queen of Hearts and how many times these cards flash up on top of the artifacts. And what we don't notice, or what we fail to notice, right under our very eyes, is that these artifacts are disappearing, just like in real life. And this follows the real research of Simons and Chabri. You might know this this test where you're asked to look at the number of times, count the number of times a basketball is passed between these different players. And what you don't see is that a man in a gorilla suit walks right through. Well, this phenomenon of not seeing, or attention blindness, as they call it, is what her artwork was actually testing. So the artwork actually mimics the real experiment, only in an art gallery context. So in summary, a lot has changed in the Academy since C.P. Snow's controversial publication, Two Cultures and the Scientific Revolution, which was published in 1959. And this is a book that that actually pitted the humanities and the sciences in opposition to one another. And a lot has changed even since the publication of The Third Culture by John Brockman, which was published in 95. And this is a book that discusses the work of scientists who are directly communicating their sometimes provocative ideas to non-scientists. So likewise, the ArtSci Fellows Program and the Vertical Seminar Program provided a vital platform to articulate the intrinsic value of arts practice and seed the ground for new cross-disciplinary collaborations in which artists, designers, architects, and scientists address common questions and communicate beyond disciplinary boundaries. More broadly, both programs supported the university's commitment to discovery at the intersections of art, science, and technology, and aligned the institution with a consortium of others that are also evolving third culture thinking. Thank you.